Have you ever wondered how image classification works on medical images? Welcome back to LearnOpenCV. In this video, I will introduce you to the concept of multi-label classification specifically for medical images. I'll also give you hands-on insights about this concept using a Google Colab notebook. Alright, let's get this started. Before we dive deep, it's important to understand the basic terminologies. Classification is the process of categorizing or grouping objects into predefined classes. Just have a look at the visualization shown on screen. What can you observe? We can see that there are three types of classification. They are binary classification, multi-class classification, and multi-label classification. In binary classification, we show multiple images of two classes to the model and ask it to classify using the sigmoid activation function. In multi-class classification, the model recognizes and categorizes the images into two or more classes. We can observe that the source image goes into the classification model and passes the output components through a softmax activation function. This computes the probability for each class output and cross entropy loss is computed. Based on this, the final multi-class predictions are obtained. But in the case of multi-label classification, it is equivalent to solving n binary classification problems. Similar to the multi-class classification, the source image moves into the classification model where each output feature map from the model passes through an individual sigmoid activation function. From here, a binary output is obtained from each sigmoid function using binary cross-entropy loss function. For this project, I will use the ZeroGANs Human Protein Atlas dataset from Kaggle. There are about 10 classes in this dataset, such as mitochondria, nuclear bodies, nucleoli, Golgi apparatus, nucleoplasm, nucleoli fibrillar center, cytosol, plasma membrane, centrosome, and nuclear speckles. Let's quickly hop onto a Google Colab notebook and try to practically implement multi-label classification. Initially, the pip install command is used to install the necessary dependencies. Few important ones are Kaggle, TorchInfo, PyTorch Lightning, scikit-learn, and TorchMetrics. In the dataset and base operations section, two classes, dataset config and training config, have been initialized. The dataset config class takes care of important parameters such as image size, number of classes, and the path definitions for all the directories within the dataset. Whereas the training config class takes care of the batch size, the number of training epochs, and the parameters similar to that. In the data preparation section, we can observe that the labels have been initialized for every class ID in the dataset. Variable rev is a dictionary mapping that maps class names in string format to the class IDs. And in this notebook, we've already created a folder which contains images that contain only a single class. We can see the visualization on the screen as well. A few helper functions are required for the following tasks. Encode label. This function converts labels in string format into a vector of zeros and ones depending on the provided label. Decode target. This function converts the model's predictions from a vector from probabilities to a string of integers or their string representations. Denormalize. This function is used to denormalize the image tensors and clip values between 0 and 1. It is helpful during image visualizations. After this, we need to define a custom PyTorch dataset class named as Human Protein Dataset. This provides a standardized interface to load and pre-process dataset samples from various sources. The custom class encapsulates the following steps. Download the dataset from Kaggle, create train and validation splits, create a dataset class object for each split with appropriate transformations, and create data loader objects for each split. The prepare data method is used for data preparation like downloading and one-time pre-processing with the dataset. When training on a distributed GPU, this will be called from a single GPU. The setup method is used to perform train, validation, and test splits. There are three separate methods to create the train data loader, validation data loader, and test data loader. With this, we can look at the data distribution of this particular dataset. Looks like there is an imbalance in this dataset. We'll also generate a grid of images just for visualization purposes. To do so, we'll use the makeGrid function available in Torch Vision. Here are the visualizations. In this section, we can load any classification model available within Torch Vision by just passing parameters such as model name, number of classes, and freeze backbone. A function usage example has also been shown over here. The final custom class we need to define is the protein model class, which inherits from the lightning module class. The lightning module class helps to properly organize the PyTorch code into separate sections for training and evaluation. In an imbalanced dataset where the number of instances of one class greatly outnumbers the other, a model could achieve high accuracy simply by predicting the majority class all the time. In such cases, the F1 score is a commonly used metric. It is the harmonic mean of the precision and recall, the two foundational measures of a model's effectiveness. To calculate the F1 score for this particular task, we will use the multi-label F1 score class from the Torch Metrics library and the macro average reduction method. In this project, pre-trained EfficientNet V2S model was chosen. Binary cross entropy with logits loss has been used with multi-label F1 score as the evaluation metric. By initializing our protein model and protein data module classes and passing them to the .fit method of the trainer class instance, we can promptly commence training. This streamlined approach eliminates the need of manual implementation of various aspects, providing convenience and efficiency. Inference results have been given on this notebook, linked in the description. Please have a look at it. But here's an example of Hugging Face spaces where we've deployed the fine-tuned model using Gradio. And that's a wrap for today's video. Make sure to like and subscribe to our channel for more exciting computer vision content. If you have any questions or suggestions, feel free to leave them in the comments down below. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.